Hello and welcome to Norwegian Woods. In this video I'm going to tell you everything I know about camping and bushcraft sauce. As you probably already know, there are a lot of different sauce out on the market, and it can be a little bit difficult to know what sauce to pick. They come from the really small ones up to the pretty big ones, and there's also all the good stuff in the middle. First, I want to say a few words about the history of the sauce in this part of the world, because back in the days, back all the way back to the Stone Age and up through the Viking Age and all the way to the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, the axe was the main tool for the woods, because they didn't have the technology to make this really thin pieces of steel that you need for a good saw. I found some little bit conflicting information on this topic, because some sources say that they didn't use saws at all, and other sources show that they found some saws in graves and other kinds of archaeological finds from the Viking Age. So there has been a little bit of use of saws back in the days, but it wasn't the big, really useful saws that you can use to cross-cut to take down big trees. It was smaller saws, some even hardened, so you can use them for metalwork in blacksmithing. But when the Industrial Revolution set in Scandinavia in the mid 1800s, they started to make some really good steel over in Sweden, and that's when they started to make this kind of sauce. It's called a tigersvans in this part of the world. I don't know English correct terminology for this kind of saw, but it was quite a revolution over having to use just the axes. They had this one-hand saws, and they also had some really similar, a little bit longer, with a handle on both sides. And these saws were in heavy use in these woods for about 100 years before the chainsaws came in the 1950s. But I think most people will agree that this saw is a little bit too big to carry for hiking and just general bushcraft. And it's tempting to pick some smaller and lighter saws, but just be aware, you have to pick a tool that's actually a real tool. I want to read you a quote from this book, Mors Kohansky's bushcraft book. A really good book, by the way. "An inferior but portable tool is useless in serious wilderness living. A big bow saw may be awkward to carry, but it recoups the extra energy used in lugging it around in the first half hour of sawing. On a winter's day, when you're tired, cold and hungry, the last thing you need is a tool that is the shadow of the real thing." The first thing I want to say about saws is, if you're going to buy yourself a saw, buy a real one. I remember back in the 80s, I got this survival knife, and it's got some saw-like thing on the back here, but it's really not useful as a saw at all. And inside this handle, there was also this wire saw, and it was I used it a couple of times before it broke, but it's these kinds of sauce are just toys. It's not real sauce. Another thing I want to mention is a lot of sauce you can buy are like a bow sauce, and as you can see on this one, it has a triangular shape like this, and this creates a problem because the distance from the saw blade and up to the handle in the front there is getting really narrow. So in reality, this saw isn't useful more than like this part of it. So if you're going to buy some kind of bow saw, make sure it's got some more space between the saw blade and the handle, because it limits the diameter of the wood you're going to saw with it. The next quality of a saw that you should be mindful of is the weight, because if you're going to use the saw for camping or hiking or backpacking, then you have to carry it in the woods, and then it can be a little bit of a hustle, and it can be tempting to just bring a small one like something like this. And in the summertime, this may be perfect, just for some little whittling and doing some really small tasks. And in the wintertime, it can be tempting to to bring something like this. I have actually been carrying a chainsaw in the woods for camping, and it's a real pain because it's heavy. Especially if you have to carry it in your hand. If you can attach it to your backpack, it gets a little bit easier. But it's a really dangerous tool, and I'm not confident enough to use it. So I prefer to bring something a little bit smaller. Oftentimes, you see people and choosing something like a little folding saw like this Bucko Laplander, or a bow saw like this, and this one is lighter and it's more portable. It doesn't take much space at all, you can see the comparison. And weight wise it's a little bit lighter, but this can actually do a lot more work. So of course you have to make this choice for yourself, but I think it's worth to take a little bit heavier tool, especially in the winter time, to be able to make some real firewood. And this Bucko Laplander folding saw is just too small, I think. Lately I've been testing out this Silky. It's called the Silky Sugoi 420, and it's one of the biggest Silky saws. And so far, I have to say it's been really good. It cuts effortlessly, especially in greenwood, which is of course not suitable for firewood, but for making stuff, it's something completely different from this old technology and this bow saw. So a little bit later in the video, I will be doing some test cutting between this and a couple of the other ones I got with me. So it should be interesting to see how it performs. You can also see in this comparison the size of the saw blades compared to the thickness of the wood you're going to cut. It's pretty much given what size, the minimum size you have to use for a certain size log. The next thing you should consider when buying a saw is if the saw blade is straight like this, or if it's curved like this one. it has the inside curve, and the big saw like this has a slight curve the other way. Previously I have mostly used straight cutting blades like this, and it's pretty good. It's like this saw, it cuts both ways, both on the push and the pull stroke. And this silky saw, it cuts just on the pull stroke. And this curving blade, it seems to like pull the saw more into the cut. It feels like it's giving the saw a lot more cutting power from the use I've had on this one so far. Another thing I think you should know about saws that's important is that the size of the teeth on the saw makes a huge difference in how effective the saw is going to cut. Like this this carpenter saw, it's made for really detailed work, and it's got some pretty small teeth, while this huge forest working saw has some really big teeth that really digs into the wood in a completely different way than the small teeth on this other saw. Another thing about the teeth of the saw is that they are not completely in a straight line. They're on most saws, they're bent a little bit. And as you can see here, this saw blade, this sawtooth, is pointing in that direction. And that's on the outside, and then the sides is sharpened on the outside of the teeth. And the next tooth, like this, is pointing in this direction, just not much, just slightly, and it's sharpened on the outside, like here. And this makes the cut of the saw a little bit wider than the saw blade itself. So it's making the saw blade travel easier without binding into the wood. I also see on this this blade is one of the blades for my bow saw. It's also bent. Every second tooth is bent either way. So it's the same principle as the big Tiger's ones. Another way you can achieve this the same thing is the way you can see on this Silky saw. Silky is one of the manufacturers that actually makes the saw blade thicker at the cutting side of the blade, and it narrows down towards the bottom of the blade itself. So then you don't have to bend the teeth of the saw blade to make the cut a little bit thicker at the cutting edge, and then narrower at the back edge of the saw, to prevent it from binding in the cut itself. When you look at the tooth pattern on this Silky saw, you see that the tooth doesn't bend. It's just slightly tapered from the back of the blade until the cutting edge, and it's sharpened like this. It's sharpened on this side, and this is sharpened on this side. So every second tooth cuts left and right of the saw blade. It's a clever way to do it. It seems to work really, really good. The stand that's holding this old bow saw is an old piece that's been in use on a farm a bit further north from where I live in Norway. So it's a cool thing. And it's really useful because some of these old saws, some of the new ones, are made to be sharpened. And that's kind of a science in itself. I'm not an expert, but I'll give you a little bit of an insight. And this old tiger swan saw, it's made for sharpening. Also, this particular model of silky saws is also made to be sharpened when it gets dull over time. Most other modern saws, like this carpenter saws, you just use them until they are dull, then you just throw them away and buy a new one. And with this bow saws, you just change the saw blades. I just changed one on this right now, so it's perfectly fine for the test cutting. The way you sharpen this this saw is that first you have to make sure that all the sawtooth is at the same height, and then you use a special tool like this. It's a file with this guiding jig on it that you put on top of the saw like this, and you straighten all of the teeth on the saw. There's no use for this at this moment, because this saw is in really good shape. Then you take a file like this. It's a little bit like a diamond shaped with a fine cut. And when you have the saw mounted in a stand like this, it's not all that difficult to get the right angles. Then you start to sharpen every second tooth like this, so it's cutting on the right side of the tooth to which way it's bending. After you're done with the filing, you have to use a special tool like this. It's adjustable angle for the setting of each tooth, and you take every second and bend them the way they're supposed to be. So as you can see, with this setup you can maintain a professional working tool that's been in use in the forests around here for about 100 years, until the 1950s. There are also a few other things you should be mindful of regarding saws. One thing is that, like this saw, when you cut with it, it cuts both on the push and the pull motion, back and forth, cuts both ways. With this Japanese saws, like this silky, it cuts only on the pull stroke. It doesn't cut on the push. And it's important to be mindful of it, because if you take a saw like this and you give too much energy in the forward motion, you can end up bending and breaking the saw blade. That's not a good thing to do when you're out in the woods, and depending on the saw. Like with this bow saws, they also work in both directions. These can also break. If you give them some twist, it doesn't take too much to break them. I haven't done it myself, but I've seen it happen before. And a broken saw is no good use. Another thing to be mindful of with saws is the thickness of the blade. It determines how much wood you are removing. This is a fret saw. It's got a really, really thin, narrow blade. That's you're able to do a lot of things with this that you can't do with other kinds of saws, just because it's a very thin blade. Maybe the opposite is like a chainsaw. It has a really wide chain which makes a big cut. And of course, this is not hand operated in the same way as all the other saws. So it doesn't take too much effort to cut a wide cut with this chainsaw. But if the saw blade is very wide, just think about this, then you have to remove much more wood. That means more work. But there's also this thing that with a really narrow cut, the saw blade tends to bind in the cut more easily. than we do with the wider cut. That's why we have this bending of the set of the sawtooths to prevent this. Another thing that also can be a factor when choosing a saw is the looks of the saw, of course. Especially for like bushcrafters and people that do this as a hobby. If you have a nice saw with a wooden handle like this Opinel, it looks good, and it makes you feel a certain way. The same with this big old Tiger's ones. It's a wooden handle. It looks and gives a certain feeling when you use it, compared to something like this simple industrial product. It's not very pretty. It does the job, of course, but the same with some of these. This newer, more maybe a little bit gimmicky, I don't know. Tools like this, I don't think a saw like this gives me the same satisfaction when I take it and use it as this Opinel. It just looks and feels different. For some people that maybe doesn't matter at all, but for some it maybe it do. Yet another thing that makes saws different is the amount of control you have in the cuts. With a saw like this buck saw, I think it's called a buck saw or a tenon saw in English, it gives a lot of precise control when you start and you go through with the cut. It's if you're going to do some fine woodworking and stuff like this, I don't think a rough bow saw like this would be the best tool. This gives a lot more control of the cut than this one. So, oftentimes when you need the saws the most is in the wintertime, when you're depending on gathering firewood. And when it gets cold, when it gets way below freezing, getting like between 10 and 20 degrees negative Celsius, close to 0 degrees Fahrenheit, then something happens with the steel in everything. That goes for both axes, knives and saws, and yeah, other tools as well. The cold affects the brittleness, the hardness of the steel. So if you go out and it's really cold, the saw is a lot more prone to breakage, because the steel gets brittle because of the cold temperature. I have not heard that many people talk about this, and I haven't been able to find any data on it. Maybe the manufacturers don't want to release this information about their steel. I don't know, but you should be mindful of it. And this saws like this saw that has this pull cut, it gets, if you get a little bit twist on it, it gets a bend when you return the blade, and in the winter time it can break. Same goes for this. And with axes, you can have an axe that works perfectly well in the summertime, but when you go out in the really cold winter temperatures and you start to chop wood, suddenly you chip off large chunks of steel from the edge of the axe, just because of the temperature and the brittleness caused by the temperature. So be really mindful of that. Take extra care when you're using your tools out in the cold weather. One more thing you should be mindful of when traveling out in the winter time is how easy accessible the saw is in your pack. Because most of the times when I travel out in the woods, I put this saw inside my pack, close to my back, and I put in the the saw and my axe in front of it, and I stuff all my other gear on top of this. So when I'm going to use it, I have to take out a lot of stuff from my backpack. And it hasn't been a problem. But if something should happen to me, if I fell through some ice, got into the water, got really cold, if I fell and broke something, I'm not sure if it would be a really good idea to have the saw hard to access in your pack. Even worse, if you had some kind of a buck saw that you had to assemble, you had to put together a lot of small pieces, and if you suddenly needed the saw, I don't know if that's a good idea. Maybe I should put the saw on the outside of my pack in the winter time. It would be better. Maybe something like this silky saw that has a sheet with some room for some straps that I can just put on the outside of my pack, and it would be really easy to access it and use it just with one hand, even. No assembly, no nothing. So maybe that's a good thing to be mindful of as a safety precaution. Now I want to talk just a little bit about all the different saws I brought with me. And I think I'll start with this Victorinox. It's a nice little saw. It cuts really effective for its size. I actually got two of them, two different sizes. You see there's a little bit of a difference in size, but they're both it's small and tiny in size. And I think the Leatherman saws are also pretty good. I don't have a saw on my Leatherman tool, but they're supposed to be the same quality as these. And they're good to bring as a backup for something. I would not consider this as a tool for gathering firewood at all. Next up is my little Opinel. It's a French saw. It's exactly the same style as the Opinel knives. This is the smaller version. They also make a little bit larger one. And these are also like the Japanese saws. It's a pull cut saw. I haven't used this all that much. I bought it a little while ago, but I think it looks really nice. So it's a beautiful little saw. Maybe a little bit too small to make firewood, definitely, but as part of a wood carving kit, maybe it has some use. Next up is my Bucko Laplander. It's a really popular saw. It's okay. I would say it's an okay saw. It's still a little bit too small for firewood gathering, especially in the winter time. Maybe if you just want to make some small cooking fire in the weather like this, because I can't make fires. It's a fire ban in all of Norway all summer, so that sucks, but that's the way it is. But for stuff like this small folding saw, it's nice. And of course, all folding saws are handy because they have edge protection built in, so it's convenient to use a folding saw. I think there are some better folding saws on the market. So I don't know if I'm really all that happy with this purchase. I can't complain, but it's a small saw and it doesn't cut all that good. So yeah, it is what it is. The next saw I brought is this little fret saw. It's like a jigsaw or a fret saw. It's good for woodworking, for tiny detail work. You can make a hole through a piece of wood and take this thin blade out, pull it through the hole, and you can saw like figures and shapes. It's a unique tool, and if you need a tool like this, nothing can replace it. It's not expensive, so it's a nice thing to have in the toolbox for those occasions you want to make something and need it. Not something for firewood. It's a bow saw, but it's not. Yeah. When you move into like professional carpenter and woodworking tools, there are so many different different saws. And a lot of them can be really useful in a woodland environment, like this little buck saw or a tendon saw is for detailed work. I have never brought this out in the woods before, and I don't think I will probably do it again. I just did it this time for to show this tooth pattern. I don't have a edge protection for it. I've lost it. So that's one of the main reasons why it's really inconvenient to lug this little saw around, because it's pretty sharp. And all the other carpenter and woodworking saws you can get for cheap, so it's for some maybe that's the way to start in bushcraft saws. I don't know. My suggestion is to go for something that's built a little bit more purposeful for that kind of use. One way you could go instead of the carpenter tools for a cheap option is this this bow saws. They are effective and they are cheap, and you can buy just the saw blades, and you can make your own saws. I'll come back to that a little bit later. Just be mindful of that I talked about with the angle of the frame, so it doesn't get too shallow like this this blue one. It's really not useful actually for cutting big logs at all, but this one somehow managed to do. And also you can see that the length, this is 21 inch, this is my 24 inch, and I think I wouldn't go any smaller than a 24 inch. In if I didn't have to carry it, maybe a 36 inch, a full size, would be a good idea, but it's starting to get big and a little bit heavy, so I think 24 for me is a good compromise. I also brought this one. This is a really old bow saw. It's probably 100 years old. It's from the farm where my grandmother grew up. And I haven't used it. And if I did, the saw blade would probably break because it's pretty rusty. But what's interesting is that it's made from one piece of wood. It's just a blade and a bent piece of wood. I don't know exactly what kind of wood it is. Maybe it's juniper. I don't know. Yeah. But this is an easy way to get the cheap quality cutting tool for the woods. Just buy the saw blade and make the rest. This next saw I brought with me is a Silky Sugoi 420. And this is the largest non-folding saw that Silky makes. I contacted Silky because I really wanted to try out one of their saws, and I didn't find any local dealers close to me. So Silky put me in contact with a Norwegian distributor. It's called Skogsmaskiner. I will put a link to their website in the description of this video. And they agreed to send me this saw, and I haven't used it all this much yet, so I've done some testing, and I will later in this video. I will include this in some test cutting. And so far, this saw has been impressive, I have to say. Next up is this huge one, this Tigersvans. I don't know if it's if it fits inside the frame. I don't know, but it's an old kind of saw. It was introduced in the middle of the 1800s, about 1850, I think. And this particular model is from a maker in Sweden called Eia, and they made a lot of these for the Norwegian military, the Norwegian army. So there are still some brand new ones that's being stored and that's available. This saw has actually never been used. I got it from a guy that bought it from military surplus sale somewhere, and it's a serious tool. It's heavy and it's big, and it's it's made for some serious professional work in the woods. Maybe too big for backpacking, to be honest, but it's still nice saw. I have it hanging on my wall at home. It's pretty. I also brought with me this chainsaw. I bought it from Amazon, and I've never used it. I got it for this video, actually, because I wanted to do some test cutting, and I wanted to see how this this foldable hand-powered chainsaws compare to more conventional saw blades. So later, when I do a little bit of test cutting, I'm really curious how this little saw performs. The last saw I brought for this little trip is this chainsaw. I'm not a chainsaw user at this point. I've used it a little bit, but it's actually a really, really dangerous tool. If you don't know how to use it, I just should suggest you don't use it at all, because it's easy to end up in a hospital after using a saw like this. It's a really, really powerful tool, and it can do a lot of damage, both to the woods and to yourself. So, dangerous stuff. Then I want to do a little cutting test with some of the saws I brought today. I want to see how they perform. The saws I want to test is the Silky Sugoi, the survival saw, the hand-operated chainsaw, the Bako Laplander, the big Tigersvans, and my bow saw. My old Boso 24 inch. I just put a brand new blade on it, never been used. And I want to try it on a green wood and dead wood. These two logs are the ones I'm going to cut through. I also brought with me some a timer, a stopwatch. So I'll try to see how these different saws compare. Interesting. The first saw in my test is this big Tigersvans on the deadwood. So let's see how this goes. That's 23 seconds, and as you saw, it was a little bit unwieldy. I guess that's because it's I haven't used it before. But yeah, 23 seconds on deadwood for this one. The second test is the Laplander on the deadwood. See, it's about, yeah, maybe between three and four inches, so it's a little bit on the large size for this small saw, but we'll see. Yeah, that's 52 seconds. As I saw, there was a wasp that landed on me. So I take off a couple of seconds because I had to chase away this wasp. So I say 50 seconds on this bucko. Next up is my trusty bow saw, my 24 inch with a brand new bucko. Backup blade on it. So let's see how this goes. Yeah, that was about 10 seconds. It's a really good one. Next up is my new Silky Sugoi 420. See how this goes in this competition. Yeah, it was about the same as the bow saw. Maybe a little bit less. It stopped on 9.5 seconds. I guess you can time it on the video if you're really interested. But that's good. My last little test is this chainsaw. I have really no clue how this is going to work. I don't know how to use it. We'll see. This is supposed to be one of the best of these kinds of saws after what I've seen from tests, so we'll see. Yeah, that's definitely the hardest to use. Ooh, I'm out of breath. That was like 36 seconds. Then it's time for the greenwood test. And I start off with the big teakish ones. And hopefully I'll manage the technique a little bit better this time.
About 22 seconds. But as you saw, I struggle. I think it's mainly because of this really big teeth. It's a little bit flex in the blade and the big teeth. So on the outstroke, I tend to bend the blade a little bit. So it's not an easy saw to use. Next up on the Greenwood is the Bakko Laplander. This is a little bit better size for this small saw than the dry one. I think it's maybe like a little bit more than two and a half inches maybe. We'll see. Like 18 seconds. Next up is the bow saw, the 24 inch. Let's see how this goes. Six seconds. Really easy to use. Next up, the silky sugoi. Yeah, a hair less than 6 seconds, about the same as the bow saw. Yes, both of these two saws are pretty much optimal for this cutting. They're really good, both of them. The last one is this survival chainsaw. Let's see how. It's hard to even get into the position. Okay, let's see. Binding. Oh. Yeah. 20 seconds. I think if the piece of wood had a little bit more support, this saw would not be actually that bad of a choice as a backup survival kind of saw. But it's definitely the hardest to use. I think I'll try to do one more cut with each of these two saws, because they performed really good, both of them, and was really close. So I just try one more time and see if they still are exactly the same. Start off with this deadwood, with the bow saw. Yeah. About 10 seconds. That's about 10 seconds. Let's try the Greenwood. Thank you. About 5 seconds. Four and a half seconds. It's I know that after a few times of use, the effectiveness of this bozo will slow down a little bit, because these blades wear out, and these silky blades are supposed to last for a really long time. So if it's holding up over time, I will have to see. But so far, these two saws perform really, really close, and they're both really good saws. Faster than all the other ones I brought with me for this test. So that's interesting. I hope at least some of you that's been watching this video has learned something about saws, because there's a lot of information, and I'm not an expert. I'm just learning like everyone else, and I like to share what I pick up on the way. So hopefully someone makes some use out of the information I'm sharing here. I think it's kind of hard to make some definite conclusions after doing all this testing I've done today, because this saw is one of those tools that I think operates together with another tool. It's not a standalone kind of deal that can do everything. You can make some kinds of kits with a saw and one or a few other tools that you can bring out in the outdoors. And in the past, I've just brought the Swiss Army knife, because that's kind of like a small toolkit in itself, just for some hiking, just to get some exercise. Then I think it's nice to put something like a Swiss Army knife in the pocket. Other times you want to go out and maybe make just a small cooking fire, then the Bako Laplander or similar size folding saw can be a really good tool. I think it can be paired up with some larger knife, like a Sami knife or something like that, or maybe a small hatchet. That would be a good combination to create some firewood, to make some just some small cooking fires. Of course, if you want to do some more woodworking and bushcrafting, maybe you can put together a small kit with some other kinds of woodworking tools. I have a little bit of tools, and sometimes I like to bring them. And you can make this woodworking kits in a lot of different ways, depending on what you want to make. I think the most important use of a saw is when you go for some winter camping and you need to collect some larger amounts of firewood. Then I prefer to bring a good saw together with a splitting axe. I also, as a companion, I bring my bushcraft knife, and I think that's the knife does everything the saw and the axe doesn't. Before I end this video, I want to give a huge thank you to Silky Saw and Christian Sverre at Skogsmaskiner. They sent me this saw, and if you live in Norway and you want to get yourself a Silky Saw, I would suggest you just contact Christian Sverre at Skogsmaskiner. I leave a link and contact information to him in the description box, and he will pass you on to your closest dealer of this this horse. It's worthwhile taking a look at them. I hope some of you that's been watching this video found this information useful, and maybe some of you even learned a little bit. And hopefully I'll be out pretty soon and making another video. So until then, thank you and bye bye.